executive director of the Australian Stock Exchange, the ASX Limited, and the National Australia Bank, as well as a number of other not-for-profit roles. So I'm Deputy Chancellor at the University of New South Wales, on the board of the Garvan Institute. The ASX Corporate Governance Guidelines, I think, are a fabulous initial catalyst for encouraging more women into senior management and onto boards, and having companies set their own targets and disclose. Well, I think good leadership means really standing for something worthwhile and being strong and implementing that change. It's not just a matter of talking the change, but walking the change. There are many programs overseas, not just for encouraging women, but for changing the culture to enable women to really progress. And that has to do with affordability and availability of childcare and tax arrangements that other countries do much better. I have the opportunity, as I mentioned, to study and to work in America, and I think it's an extremely valuable experience to go overseas and study. And that's why one of the things I'm associated with, the Sir John Monash Foundation, gives scholarships to young people to go and study overseas, because we believe that ability to study and work in an overseas country and then come back will make them better leaders. Companies are focused on strategy, how to implement it, what's the best way, how do they use women as advisors, how do they encourage women, how do they choose women, how do they support them to make sure they succeed. So it's definitely part of the strategy, and it's part of the role of the leader of any particular organisation to make it happen. There's a mentoring relationship that I have here with one of the young women who's a member of Advance, and that I gave her her first job, and she started off as a lawyer, and then mentored her into thinking about other opportunities. She's gone off and she now has a really senior role in Asia with Google, so I feel very privileged to have at least helped her start her career. And I encourage all women to mentor and support other women. Of course, men need to mentor as well, and we need men absolutely engaged in this debate, but it's a real privilege to mentor someone.
I suppose what I'm keen to do with this session is not to go over the same old ground that we hear again and again, and instead to look to some solutions around the question of leadership and numbers.
Yeah, I think when we talk about sustainable leadership, you know, the thing we're talking about is having having durability. So, I mean, it's all very well. I'm particularly interested in political leadership, and at the moment, you know, we have a female prime minister and three female state premiers, and everyone's saying, well, isn't this fantastic? We've made it, we've got there. And in fact, some people say, well, you know, we don't have to do anything else because we've got there. And, you know, I remember back to the early 90s when we had two female state premiers and a female chief minister in the ACT, and everyone thought we'd made it then. And then they went away, and it was another 10, 15 years before it happened again. So we don't yet have the mechanisms which ensure that once women have broken a particular barrier, that those changes endure. And I think one of the reasons for that is that our system is really out of balance. I think we need to have equilibrium, and we need to have it at a personal level and at an economic level. We don't have it at a personal level in that it's very, very difficult in our society, and there are a whole lot of reasons why, for women to be able to combine leadership roles, and particularly political leadership roles, with family life. And if we look at it from another point of view, the other great difficulty in our country, and I think probably the most critical economic issue facing the country, is the low workforce participation rate of women, particularly women with children. We are the lowest in the OECD, and yet we have the highest rate of graduation from universities. So we've got this total, we're totally out of kilter. Women can go to universities, get terrific education. 56 of university graduates are women, but they enter the workforce, and, you know, within a very short number of years, their numbers are declining and declining and
so
declining.
So what's going wrong? Is it about being mothers? Is it that it's too hard to be a mother and a leader?
Our workforce simply cannot accommodate mothers. No, we just refuse to do it.
Yeah, Angus, sorry, come to you in a moment.
If I could just take it from a slightly different context, I agree with all of the comments that have been made thus far. But I think if you look at the Defence Force I joined in 1970, if a woman got pregnant, she had to leave. If she got married, she had to leave. She was paid far less than her male counterpart. Now, over the years, all of those issues have been redressed to the point where in the Defence Force now, arguably, we would have the most women-friendly conditions of service, policies of any organisation in the country. I think our problem is getting everybody to implement those policies so that we get the effect that we're trying to achieve.
Well, you've had problems too, haven't you, with the culture of the Defence Force? I mean, there's been well publicised problems about attitudes to women in some sections of the Defence Force.
Well, I think about 50% of the Defence Force is between the age of 18 and 25. And a lot of those young people are single. You are going to, when you put that number of young people together, about 30,000, you're not always going to have perfect behaviour.
Party central.
But all I would say is that we have completely changed. When I came through, I never saw a woman in a training institution. Yeah. It was all male. Women didn't fly aeroplanes. Women didn't drive ships. Women didn't get involved in any of the more demanding roles in the army. That's all turned around. We now have 93% of positions open to women, and we're doing some assessments where I think at the end of that we will have a system where gender is not the discriminator.
Do you think that 7% will open up as well, like combat roles and things
like that? I think in the fullness of time, yeah. There's some more work that needs to be done, but it's really about physical capacity. It's not about gender. And gender should not be the discriminator in anything we do. And I could give you a large number of examples of women who are doing it. And doing it wonderfully well as leaders. At the end of this year, we will have two-star officers, Margaret Stabe, she runs our logistics, she's an Air Vice Marshal. Robin Walker will take over as Commander Joint Health. We have 7 one-star officers, that's one-star generals, and we have 31 colonels who are women. So, and then if you go down to the level below that, the young women are really starting to come through, because you go to the Defence Academy, I reviewed a parade there a couple of weeks ago, and I just couldn't get over the number of young women who were there side by side with their male counterparts as part of the new generation of leaders that will come through over time into the Defence Force. So give it time. In the Defence Force, you're going to see an increasing level of participation, particularly at the leadership level. It'll get better and better over time, and I think it's not beyond the realms of possibility. In fact, I would like to come back with my walking stick in 20 years' time and find one of the service chiefs or even the CDF as a woman. And I think that's entirely possible with the right sort of leadership and the right sort of culture within the Defence Force.
I want to talk to you a little bit about culture in a moment, because I think everybody agrees about shifting culture and changing culture, and the point you make I think is really interesting about just how far the Defence Force has come in the time that you've been in it in terms of the numbers of women that you've seen there. But before we get to that cultural question, Michelle, I wanted to ask you what you think standing in the way.
If I can sort of just mention, one thing that was sort of very obvious to me in my experience over the last sort of 20 years is, I've only really worked in Australia for the last 18 months for 18 months out of the last 20 years. And those 18 months were the most hellish of my life in terms of childcare. I mean, by a long, long, long way. It was, I had a two-year-old. I'd been in London for 5 years, came back with a two-year-old. And had her in a preschool that opened at 8 in the morning and closed at 6. And if you weren't there at 6, they would charge you $10 for every minute that you were late. And then if you were more than 10 minutes late, you picked the child up at the police station. And this was a good one. But the alternatives were sort of full-time nannies that were going to take up 50% of my sort of after-tax income. Which didn't make a lot of sense. And, my sort of classic memory, and this is, as I said, a long time ago, at least sort of 10 years ago, but, I used to have an 8:15 management meeting at Piemont, and the childcare centre was attached to Sydney Uni. and it opened at 8, I used to bundle, you know, my poor sort of 2-year-old out of the car so fast, you know, shove her in the door, you know, drive like a kamikaze sort of down Parramatta Road to be sort of, you know, functional for an 8:15 management meeting as if nothing had happened, you know. And
calm face.
Exactly, calm face. You know, when all I could hear was her screaming in the sort of background. And, you know, it was very, and you sort of end up relying so much on family and friends. And, you know, my mother used to sort of very often get the call at, you know, 5:45, please, can you go and, you know, I'm stuck in something, can you go and pick up, you know, Bella at 6.
Now, is that because you've worked in Asia a lot and because it's possible, it's much easier in
Asia?
Honestly,
when I got to Asia, it was a revelation. Mm. I mean, it wasn't an issue anymore. And, you know, and when you sort of realise how overburdened you are when you're sort of operating in Australia with children, you sort of realise that it's no wonder women opt out, because it's too bloody hard. Mm. You know, it genuinely sort of is. Mm. And I think it's a miracle that you know, women actually sort of go through the system considering those kind of, you know, barriers.
If I could just add, you talk about what other countries do differently. There are other countries where childcare is just provided by the state. So in France, which does have higher percentages of women in business, the state just provides childcare, and it's not a cost factor, and it's much more available. I don't know what age it is that it's provided until, but in some countries, childcare is just not the issue that it is today.
Okay, yeah. So is it mostly about those issues, or is it bigger than that? Is it about attitudes to women in leadership roles and about culture? I know, Jillian, you were talking about culture. You think there's a need for a cultural shift here as well?
Yes. No, I definitely do. I think that there's a lot of, we've all spoken about it in other places, but unconscious bias. I think it permeates business, permeates management teams, and it needs to be redressed. It can be redressed, and it takes exceptional leadership to do that. And that's what we're talking about leadership, and it's almost circular. We need leaders to bring about the cultural change to enable more women leaders. So we really need to look at male leaders who represent the majority out there, who are the sorts of leaders who understand how we need to level the playing field or redress the balance.
I just wonder how much productivity you all think we're losing as a nation by not having more women leaders and by not actually utilising the skills base.
Well, it has been measured. I mean, the Goldman Sachs report measures the fact that, you know, if we had more or less equal workforce participation between women and men in this country, it would add 11% to GDP. I mean, that's a big number. It's a very big number. And you'd think that alone would provide a very powerful motivation for governments to do what they need to do and for employers to do what they need to do to ensure that women can participate far more freely than they're able to. And I think the problems are, in addition to those that have already been mentioned, though I must say I'm not sure how unconscious a lot of this bias is. I think a lot of it's very conscious and very blatant. And the Howard versus Heidi thing, to me, just exemplifies the fact that, you know, if there's a girl's name on it, there's unequal treatment compared with the boy's name being on something. So I think, you know, there is blatant discrimination still. That's a huge problem. But the other things is that the sorts of changes that need to be made to the workforce to accommodate the needs of parents, let's stop saying mothers, but parents, because, you know, sometimes, and increasingly, men want to do the part-time job. There is still enormous, now we don't mind people working part-time, but they have to accept the fact that they're never going to get anywhere. You know, they can have a job, but they're not going to get promoted. Mm. So, you know, we do have what used to be called the mommy track. Now it's perhaps the parent trap. You know, you can have your flexible work, but forget about, you know,
promotion.
Yeah, exactly.
And what do you think needs to change?
Oh, where do you start? I think that there's a few things. I mean, I think that having very direct conversations about, you know, this is just unacceptable. I mean, it's unacceptable from a talent perspective. It's unacceptable from, you know, an equity perspective. It's unacceptable from every perspective.
This is a time for thank yous. As you know, and as Josephine mentioned yesterday evening, this has been a conference that we have put together over quite a long time. It has been a conference that has really been shaped by Australian-based leaders, by the advanced team, by our diaspora, and with the great support of the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade and with the private sector. It's been a true partnership. We'll be right back.